What's going on, guys? Welcome to the Sunshine Sports Network, your number one source for all things Miami sports. Today is our very first video on the channel, and just to start the video off, I'd like to say thank you so much for watching, for taking your time to check out what I have to say. And if you could do me even a bigger favor and just hit the subscribe button down below and hit the bell notification so that you can know whenever I'm putting videos out about the Dolphins or the Heat or anything going on Miami sports. What we're gonna be talking about is potentially the most polarizing player that we've seen coming into the NFL draft in a really long time. It's no surprise that a lot of teams have this guy at the very top of their draft board, and we're gonna go ahead and dive in, take a look at what I think this guy looks like as a prospect. We're going to be talking about Tua Tagovailoa today, quarterback out of Alabama. So with every NFL prospect, I think it would make a lot of sense to make a pros and a cons list. So what do you think this guy offers to your team, and what do you think this guy's potential risks are if you draft him? And I want to go ahead and go over my personal pros and cons list for Tua Tagovailoa. So pro number one, his arm talent. Tua Tagovailoa has had some of the best arm talent in college football for the last few years. And I don't see that changing anytime soon, even as he enters into the NFL. He has great accuracy when he's throwing short, intermediate, deep routes. He knows how to throw guys open, and I think that's a really good mark for a quarterback. When you can put the ball where the ball needs to be so that only your receiver can catch it, that to me is a standout kind of attribute for a quarterback coming into the NFL. Tua absolutely has that trait. He knows what he's doing on the football field, and he knows how to throw his guys open. I think it's a huge, huge benefit to him. Pro number two, his mental processor. Tua's mental processing is very, very solid. He knows how to read the defense. He kind of almost seems like he knows what the defense is going to do before they do it, and a lot of that has to do with pre-snap reads. Now, something that kind of goes hand in hand with that is his pocket presence. Tua is really good at feeling when there's pressure coming his way and getting out of that pocket, stepping forward if he needs to, or kind of scrambling out, extending the play, letting the play kind of develop a little bit more. And Tua is almost as good as anybody in that regard, especially in college. And I think that will translate to the NFL, especially with the way the NFL is playing today. You know, the style of play is starting to shift in the direction of a more mobile quarterback, and Tua definitely fits that mold. All right, my third pro for Tua, and it's my final one on my list, is the coaching that he's had in college. Now, a lot of people, when they talk about Tua, say, you know, well, yeah, of course he's gonna succeed. He's had the best talent around him. He's had the best coach of all time coaching him. And you know, he's just been on a dynasty of a football team his entire career. How could you not succeed with that? I think that actually bodes well in his favor, and here's why. Tua is playing with the best talent in college football. He is playing on a dynasty of a team in college football. Nick Saban has built the equivalent of what the New England Patriots have been in the NFL in college. They're always competitive, they're always in the hunt, they're always top five almost every season. If Saban's willing to hand the keys over to a quarterback for Alabama, hey, quarterback must be pretty good. Since I can ever remember, it's always been about phenomenal running game, kind of just a game managing quarterback, and great defense. And that's what's won them championships. So Nick Saban handing the keys over to a quarterback to be the foundational piece of this football team, I think speaks a lot to what Tua brings in the locker room, on the football field, off the field. Just all in all, as a quarterback, I think that is heavily in his favor in terms of when you're evaluating him as a quarterback and as a prospect for the NFL. So that's gonna wrap up my pros, and I'd like to take a look at my cons here. So con number one, he's a bit on the smaller end. He's 6'1", so it's not as big as me personally I would like for a quarterback. I would prefer to be more in the 6'4", 6'5", area. I feel like that's better for the NFL, just in general. Guys are bigger. So, you know, bigger defensive linemen means that you're gonna need to have bigger offensive linemen. It's gonna be hard for a short quarterback to be able to see that play develop or get a throw off in time. So the size to me is a negative against Tua, but at the same time, the NFL is a very changing game, and right now it's trending towards shorter, more mobile quarterbacks. And I feel like that's kind of been the trend over the last handful of years. When you're evaluating quarterbacks nowadays, size isn't the biggest issue. Size doesn't make the talent of the quarterback. the talent of the quarterback is what's the most important. So Tua's size is a little bit of a knock against him, but in today's NFL, like I said, it's really not that big of a deal. So let's move on to con number two. So Tua's second con, he's left-handed. And the con, the reason for it being a con is because we just don't know how that's going to translate into the NFL. We don't really know if his receivers are going to adapt right away to the ball spinning in opposite direction. Tua's blind side is his right side, so you're gonna have to either slide a good left tackle over to right tackle or pick up a right tackle, make sure that they can protect his blind side. And then, you know, in some cases you might have to adjust schemes for the offense to fit the fact that he is a left-handed quarterback. So we don't really know how that's going to translate into the NFL. A lot of people have that as a negative, you know, oh, well, he's left-handed. I don't really like left-handed quarterbacks. Seems like receivers are more, they are more used to right-handed quarterbacks. So the spin of the ball, just how it's going to release out of their throw is just a lot different when you're dealing with a left-handed quarterback as opposed to a right-handed quarterback. And the last one that we've seen in the NFL is Tim Tebow. And it just didn't work out. It didn't work out in the NFL. And I know a lot of that had to do with his mechanics. But I wonder if part of that just had to do with the fact that he is left-handed. There's something to consider there. So to his left-handedness, that could be con number two. Okay, third on my cons list, my final one, and definitely the biggest one, something that everybody is going to be talking about when they evaluate Tua, is his injury history. I do have a map of kind of all of the injuries that he's gone through since that's all started for him. And we're just gonna walk through it real quick. So starting off the list, March of 2018, Tua broke his finger while he was throwing the ball. He threw the ball, he hit his offensive lineman, it broke his finger, no play time missed, and it was in March, so really nothing too significant there. Not a huge injury. Quarterbacks break fingers, break hands, all that all the time, and it's a pretty speedy recovery, especially if it's just a finger. So that's not a big deal to me. I don't really care about that. Now, October of 2018, his second injury that's reported is where my concern begins, and I'll explain why. October of 2018, he sprains his knee. Now, Tua did not miss any time with that knee sprain, but knee sprains are a significant thing. If you don't take care of sprains properly, it can really escalate the injury. It can make it a lot worse, and that's especially so when you're dealing with your knees. The knees are a very important part of the body, especially athletically. So Tua spraining his knee, while it's not the biggest issue, I still think is significant. And it's a cause for concern because you don't want bad knees on your quarterback. So we're gonna move on from sprained knee 1 month later. So we're looking at November of 2018. He injures his left quad. He does that versus Mississippi State, and he does leave the game. He didn't miss any further games beyond that. That to me, kind of like a finger, it's not that big of a deal. I don't really see that as a super important injury to focus on or worry about. So I'm okay with that. It doesn't really bother me that much. So we're moving past that. So we're going 1 month later, and this is where the significant injuries start. This is where the big ones happen, where when you're evaluating Tua, you have to consider these. You have to take these into account because they are significant and they are impactful to his college career, and they could be impactful to his NFL career. The first one that happens, December of 2018, is a high left ankle sprain. That was against Georgia in the SEC championship game. That's a big game. Those are, you know, pretty much everything's at stake. Tua comes out and proceeds to have tightrope surgery on his left ankle. So tightrope surgeries are pretty routine surgery. It kind of cleans things up in the ankle a little bit. It's really not a big deal at all, and the recovery process for tightrope surgery is usually pretty simple and pretty easy. He came back within a month, did not miss any further games, actually went on to play against Oklahoma in the college football playoffs, and they won the game. After that injury, Tua, he had a clean bill of health for almost a year. We're looking at 10 months of Tua being completely healthy and ready to go on the football field and also into the college season. But in October 2019, he suffers a high right ankle sprain against Tennessee, and he has the same procedure done on his right ankle. Now, the final injury in Tua's college career is the biggest one, and it's one that everybody knows about. He's still rehabbing and recovering from it, and it was his hip dislocation, and that was a significant injury. He dislocates his hip, and he fractures the wall of his hip as well, like the socket of his hip wall. fractures that, and then he suffers a severely broken nose as well. Within 48 hours, he's taken into surgery. He has surgery and is still on the road to recovery. Now, the question that I have, and the question that a lot of people struggle with, is what are we gonna do with that number 5 pick? And I'm gonna ruffle a lot of feathers here. I don't think that we should take Tua with the number 5 overall pick. And here's my reason. The Dolphins have only had 6 top 5 picks in the franchise's entire history. I would much rather just draft offensive linemen. You got the top 5 overall pick. You're going to have someone like Andrew Thomas, Tristan Wirfs, maybe Jedrick Wills on the board. Draft one of those guys. I think a lot of Dolphins fans are hung up on, we need to draft the next Dan Marino. We need to draft the next great quarterback. We need to draft the next greatest quarterback ever. But you don't need that to win. This quarterback class this year is one superstar, another superstar who's significantly injured, and then, you know, a bunch of question marks. You don't really know what you're gonna get out of the rest of these guys. So in my opinion, when you're having the number one quarterback go off the board and your only other option is someone with significant injury, pass on it. Try to do something next year, build around Josh Rosen, trade for a quarterback, just let Ryan Fitzpatrick do his thing this year. Taking Tua would be doing everything wrong in this situation because you need to build so many other things on this football team. So what I would do here is just build your trenches, build the most important parts of your football team and plug in a good quarterback. The foundation for this team is there and all they need are some pieces to build around and they'll be there. Unfortunately, I just don't think that that's Tua. I just don't see his body being able to keep up with the NFL. Thank you so much for watching. Have a great night, guys. And as always, fins up.